So good evening everyone, we are live now, we can start.
Yeah, good evening everybody. On behalf of Maharashtra Orthopedic Association, I welcome you all for the inaugural function of 38th Foundation Day of Maharashtra Orthopedic Association. We are going to celebrate this week as a Maharashtra Orthopedic Association Foundation Day, and this is the inaugural function. I welcome Padma Shri Dr. Raman Gangakedkar sir, who is going to talk on myths and beliefs, myths and realities about vaccination in corona. And we'll be initially having a short inauguration function followed by a talk of Dr. Raman Gangakedkar sir. Again, I welcome all the MOA members, all office bearers, all past presidents of Maharashtra Orthopedic Association, and all those who have joined this function. As this is live on Ortho TV, Facebook Live and all. So I welcome all ladies and gentlemen on this platform of Maharashtra Orthopedic Association. Maharashtra Orthopedic Association is celebrating its 31st Foundation Day today. And I request our president, Dr. Shinde sir, to welcome, give his welcome speech and tell us about brief history of Maharashtra Orthopedic Association. Dr. Ajit Shinde sir, please.
Thank you, Prakash. नमस्कार माझ्या एमओएतील सर्व सहकारी मित्र एमओएचे सर्व सभासद हितचिंतक जे आज हा लाइव प्रोग्राम पाहत आहेत आपण आज सर्वजण आपल्या संस्थेचा 38वा वर्धापन दिन आहे म्हणून एकत्र आलो आहोत आज एमओए डे बरोबरच महाराष्ट्र दिवस आहे कामगार दिवस आहे महाराष्ट्र दिवस असल्या कारणाने आज मी जाणीवपूर्वक आपली महाराष्ट्राच्या मराठी आपल्या मातृभाषेत मराठीत माझे मनोगत आणि स्वागत व्यक्त करणार आहे. आजच्या या वर्धापन दिनादिवशी आणि उद्घाटनाच्या समारंभाला आपल्याला पद्मश्री श्री रमण गंगाखेडकर लाभले आहेत. ते भारतातील प्रसिद्ध व्हायरोलॉजिस्ट एपिडेमियोलॉजिस्ट असून विशेष म्हणजे आपल्या डॉक्टर व्ही एन देशपांडे यांचे वर्ग मित्र आहेत आणि ते निश्चितच आपणाला ह्या निमित्ताने मार्गदर्शन करणार आहेत. आपल्या दूरदृष्टीच्या सिनियर्सनी 1983 एक मे रोजी ह्या संस्थेचं स्थापन केली. संस्था स्थापन करताना हा त्यांच्यापुढे उद्देश होता की जे अद्यावत तंत्रज्ञान सुपर स्पेशालिटी ज्ञान जे ठराविक मेट्रो सिटीज मध्येच उपलब्ध आहे ते कानाकोपऱ्यातल्या सर्व ऑर्थोपेडिक सर्जनांना ज्ञात व्हावं आणि त्याचा फायदा तळागाळातील सर्व जनतेला मिळावा ज्यांना प्रत्येक वेळा मोठ्या शहरात उपचार घ्यायला शक्य नाही आणि ते उद्देश माझ्या मते आपण लोकांनी साध्य केलेला आहे. वर्षाला होणाऱ्या प्रत्येक वर्षी होणाऱ्या अकॅडमिक ऍक्टिव्हिटीज वार्षिक परिषद सीएमई वर्कशॉप याद्वारे कानाकोपऱ्यात हे ऑर्थोपेडिक विषयाचं आधुनिक तंत्रज्ञान पोहोचलेलं आहे आणि मला वाटतं 90% सर्व उपचार पद्धती त्या त्या गावात त्या त्या तालुका प्लेसला अथवा जिल्ह्यातच रुग्णांना प्राप्त होत आहे. हे सर्व करत असतानाच संस्थेनं ज्या वेळेला असं विचार केला म्हणजे डॉक्टर पराग संचितींनी 2018 साली हा एमओए डे साजरा करायचा संकल्पना सगळ्यांसमोर ठेवली आणि तो दिवस साजरा करताना एक आठवडा बरोबर अशा गोष्टी सामाजिक बांधिलकीतन करायच्या की ज्याचं सुद्धा म्हणजे आपल्या विषयाबरोबर वैद्यकीय क्षेत्रातल्या सुद्धा सर्व अद्यावत ज्ञान लोकांना प्राप्त व्हावं ऑर्थोपेडिक सर्जनांना त्याचबरोबर सर्व लोकांना याचा फायदा व्हावा म्हणून आपण ह्या गोष्टी करत आहोत. सुरुवातीला आपण ऑस्टिओपोरोसिस रस्त्यावरील अपघात किंवा अपंग लोकांच्या शस्त्रक्रिया या विषयाला आधारून कार्यक्रम करत होतो. परंतु गेले 2 वर्ष हा जो महाभयंकर निसर्गाचा कोप झाला आहे आणि कोरोना महामारीमुळे आपण सगळेजण त्रस्त झालो आहे, आपल्याला घराबाहेर पडणं मुश्किल झालेलं आहे, तर या विषयाचं सुद्धा ज्ञान सगळ्यांना व्हावं म्हणून या आठवडाभर संपूर्ण कोरोना विषयीचे वेगवेगळ्या विषयाला अनुसरून आपण संध्याकाळी लेक्चर नियोजित केले आहेत, त्याचाच पहिला भाग म्हणून हे लसीकरण आहे. लसीकरणाचं महत्व असं आहे, म्हणजे मला असं वाटतं आहे की ही सेकंड वेव थोपवण्यामध्ये लसीकरणाला अनन्य साधारण महत्व आहे आणि त्याविषयीच्या आपल्या सगळ्यांच्या असलेल्या शंका कुशंका त्याविषयीच आपल्याला अधिक माहिती सर आपल्याला देतील आणि ते आपण तळागाळातील लोकांना पोचवू आणि ही लसीकरणाची मोहीम जर का आपण चांगली राबवली तर मला खात्री आहे की ह्या आजाराचा प्लॅटू लवकरच येईल आणि ही साथ आपल्याला आटोक्यात आणायला प्रयत्न होईल. हे माझे दोन शब्द बोलून झाल्यानंतर मी माझे मित्र डॉक्टर व्ही एन देशपांडे यांना सांग विनंती करतो की सरांची ओळख करून द्या. त्यानंतर डॉक्टर त्याच्या आधी मला असं वाटतंय डॉक्टर पराग शेती ही संकल्पना जे एमओडे बाबतची का होती आणि संघटनेविषयीची माहिती सगळ्यांना देतील आणि त्यानंतर डॉक्टर व्ही एन देशपांडे प्रमुख पाहुण्यांचं ओळख करून देतील आणि मग आपणाला सर ह्या विषयाचं पूर्ण समाधान होईपर्यंत व्याख्यान त्याचबरोबर प्रश्न उत्तर होऊन जातील. धन्यवाद.
थँक यू शिंदे सर फॉर गायडिंग अस अँड एनलाइटनिंग युअर स्पीच. आय रिक्वेस्ट डॉक्टर पराग संचेती सर टू गिव्ह इन ब्रीफ इन्फॉर्मेशन अबाउट द कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ सेलिब्रेटिंग एमओए डे.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Prakash. Can you hear me?
Yes, yes, sir.
Thank you and good evening, everybody. Chief guest for today's MOA day function, Dr. Ganga Khedkar, our dynamic president, Dr. Ajit Shinde, past president, Dr. Deshpande, in charge of the MOA day celebration week, Dr. Prakash Sigedar, Dr. Pramod Shinde, Dr. Mahesh, Dr. Ashok Shyam, Dr. Nilima Shinde, Somavanshi, and friends. It is indeed a great pleasure for me to talk to you about the concept of the MOA Day. As you heard from Dr. Shinde, our organization was formed 38 years ago on 1st May. So we've always been celebrating MOA Foundation Day as the 1st May. But about 4 years back, when we were planning what should we do to celebrate our Foundation Day, Dr. Prakash, Dr. And the other executive committee members at that time and myself, we thought that this would be a good idea. On the 1st of May, we should celebrate as MOA Day, because as Shinde sir just said, it is also the Maharashtra Day and the Labor Day. So it was and also that day our foundation was started. So we decided to start doing some social activities, because year long there are activities which are academic activities which are for the benefit of per se the members of the association, which are the orthopedic surgeons. But then as a part of our CSR, corporate social responsibility, as a part of social service, as a part of doing something for the community in Maharashtra, we decided to start the MOA Day. And on this particular day, we do social activities. About 4 years back, we had the first time when we did it, there were camps, free camps held all over Maharashtra, free surgeries were done and education lectures were taken. After that, also there was a big drive on road safety and the golden hour concept. Shinde sir last year did a fantastic program and his concept was together, let us defeat Corona. And a lot of activities as a part of last year's MOA Day were done by Shinde sir. And we had thought that this year we would be coming to an end of the pandemic. But unfortunately, this year also, the theme is related to Corona and we want to fight Corona, as Shinde sir has said about the theme. And this is how the concept has evolved. Every year on 1st May, we will do some social activities and throughout the week. Hopefully by next year, this pandemic will be behind us and we will be able to celebrate MOA Day physically. But I appreciate Shinde sir and his executive committee for taking this initiative. And even though not physically, albeit virtually, to celebrate MOA Day. I also thank Dr. Deshpande for bringing to us very, very famous and popular person, Dr. Ganga Khedkar. I welcome you, sir. And I'm sure with your knowledge, we will all face this pandemic in a different view, different light. And hopefully, next year also, we will invite you as a chief guest. But the situation should be different. So we would like to hear from you. But before that, thank you, Dr. Prakash, for asking me to speak. Thank you, all the past presidents and Shinde sir, for this opportunity. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you very much, Parag sir. 2-3 days back, Dr. Shinde sir, president, called me and said, Prakash, we want to celebrate foundation with this year also. As you all know that second wave of corona is in full swing. And many of our family members and our members are suffering from this corona. And it is a very tough time for all of us. But in spite of that, with the enthusiastic support from President Shinde sir and all the executive committee members, we started planning. And when we started planning, first name came to my mind was, of course, Dr. Raman Ganga Khedkar sir, to call him on the first day as a chief guest. And of course, as the second wave is going on, the issues were vaccination, patient education, counseling, blood and plasma donation, which are related to the prevention of the second wave. So we are planning, we have planned this week on all these subjects. Today we are going to listen from Dr. Raman Ganga Khedkar sir about vaccination all. Tomorrow we are going to have an academic feast with Dr. Gade Goni and his team. On 3rd of May, we are going to listen to Dr. Ishwar Ginda about the drug therapy, various drugs used, remdesivir and all controversies, and what is the exact rational use, how we should use rationally, all this from Dr. Ishwar Ginda, who is a famous person. And then we are going to listen from Dr. Atul Kulkarni, who is a chief of the Janakalyan Raktapedi chain, and he is based at Pune, and he's going to talk on the plasma donation and its role in corona, COVID-19. We have a psychological counselor, Dr. Navnath Gaikwad. He is going to talk us on role importance of counseling in preventing and managing the second wave of corona. And many more. One spiritual program is also organized with the help of Dr. Parag Sancheti sir. Our secretary, unfortunately today, he is not feeling well. He has also planned some activities like medico-legal aspect of this corona pandemic and hospital management in this present scenario. So entire week from 1st May to 9th May, we are going to celebrate as a MOA Foundation week, and we have planned activities on each of the day depending upon the time given by our particular speakers and their convenience. So I welcome all of you again on behalf of Maharashtra Orthopedic Association, and I request Dr. Ashok Sham to lighten the lamp formally, digitally. Dr. Ashok Sham, please.
Excuse me, prior to that, I want to give one information.
Yes,
Dr.
sir.
Dr. Poddar from Latur is going to arrange one lecture on future of corona and how to prevent or how to prepare for third wave. And yes, that lecture will be also there in this week. Yes, this is one more additional information in our this MOA week program.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Yeah. Prakash, I request,
Can I request, Prakash sir, can we first introduce Dr. Ganga Khedkar and then do the inauguration?
After lamp lightning, Dr. Deshpande sir is going to introduce him. Okay. Because after that, sir has to go, so he may not be in.
Okay. Thank you.
We'll, no, 2 minutes, we'll finish these formalities.
Sure, yeah. Sure.
Yeah. Dr. Ashok, please.
कुरुत्वं कल्याणं आरोग्यं धनसंपदः शुभं कुरुत्वं कल्याणं आरोग्यं धनसंपदः शत्रुबुद्धि विनाशाय दीपज्योतिर्नमोस्तुते दीपज्योतिर्नमोस्तुते।
शुभं गुरुत्वं कल्याणं आरोग्यं धनसंपदः
So thank you very much Ashok for this enlightening chanting. I request Dr. Deshpande sir to introduce Dr. Raman Ganga Kedkar sir today's speaker, and I will request Ganga Kedkar sir to declare that this foundation the day has started, and then he can start with his lecture. Thank you, Dr. Deshpande sir.
Sir, good evening, everybody. Good evening, Dr. Ajit Shinde. Good evening, Dr. Raman Ganga Kedkar. Good evening, Vice President Mr. Durzad. Good evening, Parag. Parag, I must congratulate you for bowing seeds of this MOA day, and then making this into a big tray. Ajit Shinde carrying the baton ahead. So, I want to begin Dr. Ganga Kedkar's introduction with one note. Of Albert Einstein, try not to become a man of success, but rather become a man of values. Why I'm quoting Einstein is Dr. Raman Ganga Kedkar is a man of value. आणि दुसरे मला हे आइन्स्टाईनला कोट करण्यामागे उद्देश असा आहे की जर आइन्स्टाईनच्या क्लासमेटला त्याला इंट्रोड्यूस करून द्यावंस द्यायचा योग आला असता तर त्याच्या ज्या फिलिंग्स असत्या त्या फिलिंग्स मला डॉक्टर रमण गंगा खेडकरचं इंट्रोडक्शन करून देताना होत आहे कारण त्याच्याच बरोबर मी दुसरे एक कोट करू इच्छितो अजून की थिंग्स अबाउट स्मार्ट पीपल इज दॅट दे सीम लाईक क्रेझी पीपल ह्याही कोट देण्यामागे उद्देश असा की ज्या वेळेला एमबीबीएस डेज मध्ये आम्ही लोक डेव्हिडसन आणि गोलावालाची पुस्तकं समजून घ्यायचा प्रयत्न करत होतो त्यावेळेला आमचे डॉक्टर रमण गंगा खेडकर हॅरिसनच्या पुस्तकामध्ये अकंठ बुडालेले असायचे सांगायचा उद्देश असा की डॉक्टर रमण गंगा खेडकर हे जिनियस आहेत हे सांगायला माझी वेगळी गरज नाहीये त्यांचा जो सीव्ही आहे तो सीव्ही मी जर अख्खा वाचायचा ठरवला तर मला वाटतं तासभर तेच लागणार त्यालाच लागेल त्याला डॉक्टर रमण गंगा खेडकरच्या सीव्ही मध्ये 22 पानांचा तो सीव्ही माझ्याकडे पोहोचलेला आहे 11,237 शब्द त्याच्यामध्ये आहे ही इज पद्मश्री अवॉर्डी अँड मेरिट अवॉर्ड ऑन एच आय व्ही काँग्रेस इन 2016 ही हॅज 3 फेलोशिप्स अवॉर्डेड टू हिम अँड अमॉंगस्ट विच आय एम नॉट गोइंग टू रीड आउट डिटेल्स ऑफ इट त्यानंतर ही हॅड गिव्हन 5 नॅशनल अँड इंटरनॅशनल ओरेशन्स ही इज ऑन 22 प्रोफेशनल बॉडीज and 37 national expert group he is on 12 ICMR committees 7 international bodies he has professional experience with united nation agencies to the tune of 14 international agencies he has total 213 publications and total 3042 citations on his name and all these are in 144 indexed journals He has 19 publications as a team member, 5 books written by himself, and 5 chapters written by which are written by others. आता फॉर्मली हे जो त्याचा ब्रीफ सीव्ही अजून मी वाचायचं ठरवलं तर करंटली ही इज अ सीजी पंडित नॅशनल चेअर विच इज इंडियन आयसीएमआर बॉडी ही इज फॉर्मर हेड अँड डिव्हिजन ऑफ एपिडेमियोलॉजी कम्युनिकेबल डिसीजेस of ICMR New Delhi and director in charge of National AIDS Research Institute known as NARI at Pune as a head of ECD he has managed research and contributed to public health response in recent outbreaks of Nipah Zika and COVID-19 during outbreaks of Nipah and Zika I remember he telling me that Vijay this is going to be the worst disease that we are going to face but that was controlled by Dr. Ganga Kedkar's efforts very promptly and then we came and met COVID-19 the COVID-19 is all affecting all our daily routines and everything in the nation rather in the world He is a member of National Task Force Research Group and Epidemiological Research Group on COVID-19. He is a member of Lancet Commission of COVID-19. He has been a member who is empowered a group on COVID-19. He is a member of Scientific Advisory Board of ICLR. He is Banaras Hindu University, BHU, and the National Institute of Tuberculosis and Respiratory Diseases, New Delhi, and member empowered committee, Central Institute Body of New AIIMS, Ministry of Health, Family and Welfare. He is member of high-level interministerial steering committee for eco-health initiative in India, constituted by Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. He is chairman of technical resource group, that is TRG, on public-private partnership, and TRG on antiretroviral therapy and pediatric antiretroviral therapy, constituted by National AIDS Control Organization. He is a member of technical resource group on surveillance of viral hepatitis, constituted by the National Center for Diseases Control. He is expert to the Standing National Committee on Essential List of Medicines. He has been working in the field of HIV disease for over 3 decades. He is an expert in HIV medicine and associated infectious diseases, epidemiology and public health. He was one of the key players in advocacy since 1989 and has been involved in policy making at national level on antiretroviral therapy, management of opportunistic infections, prevention of mother to child transmission and STI management, in addition to other key population specific policies. He's a popular and astute HIV medicine physician. He has been a member of many prestigious international committees on different facets of HIV diseases, including those constituted by AIDS Clinical Trial Group, WHO, UNICEF, UNFPA, and UNAIDS. His efforts to empower the socially challenged population and enhancing their treatment literacy are widely appreciated. He has been awarded Padma Shri Award by Government of India. To introduce Dr. Ganga Khedkar was a Herculean task, and I'm sure how long I've gone speaking, it is not going to be complete. And therefore, I quoted in the beginning that he is a man of value. Over to you, Dr. Ganga Khedkar. Thanks for giving me the opportunity to introduce my friend. Thank you, everybody. Over to you, Raman.
हॅलो हा सर बोला ना सर शिंदे सर
नाही मला वाटतं मध्ये ट्रान्समिशन मध्ये प्रॉब्लेम आला त्यामुळे देशपांडे सरांचं आवाज बंद झालेला आहे
बँडविड्थ कमी होते
प्रमुख पाहुण्यांना तुम्ही विनंती करा असं माझं म्हणणं आहे
यस सर यस सर आय रिक्वेस्ट डॉक्टर गंगा केडकर सर टू स्टार्ट विथ हिज
प्रेझेंटेशन या नाउ आय थिंक इट बिकम्स लिटल डिफिकल्ट to listen to what I have done. I don't know what I have done. I tried to live my life. All that is in CV is a past history, but I rue the fact that we are unable to do much against this coronavirus. I really feel very sorry for the same. Now, what I'm going to do is, if you want, I can show slides, but I'm going to go extempore because we are going to have a question answer session. Now, first thing which I would like to ask is, should I go in Marathi? Should I speak in Marathi or should I go in English?
English might be better because we have people outside Maharashtra also. So that's what
I think. Quit nahi hai, sir.
English will be better on that, sir. Parag, sir.
English will be better. Theek hai.
Yeah. Sir, but what
now, let's look at coronavirus. No, the entire world woke up to a very new reality in 2020. The 31st of December, there were first reports that coronavirus, you know, perhaps is causing some kind of pneumonitis in China. And people never thought that this could be something that could pose so much of danger to the entire world. But what happened subsequently, we found that, you know, within a span of 11 days, the WHO, WR, you know, he came forward and said, let's discuss this China related syndrome there. But even within next week's time, you find that the whole activity related to coronavirus, how do we control that, was started at the highest level in the government at that time. But what was happening across in the world? You know, the first response that came was from China. What China did was they shared a genomic sequence of this SARS-CoV-2 virus, and this genomic sequence was accessed by almost everybody across the world. What National Institutes of Health did in USA was they started looking at the mRNA technology, and this was discussed on 12th of January by NIH with Moderna, which we know is one of the big manufacturers of this mRNA vaccine. And you suddenly start realizing by the time March came, all the lab experiments were already over. They went right into the phase one trials to begin with in USA. And probably about 2 months later, Pfizer started off with same mRNA technology. Their phase one trial started almost around the month of July. And you also realize that the infection was so severe that even in US, when people started conducting those clinical trials, they could finish early targets for interim analysis, mainly because the outbreak was extremely severe. Number of people who were expected to develop these infections, these new infections occurred very rapidly. And the result was, by December, you had Pfizer, which was approved. By January, you find that Moderna was approved. And at that juncture, what was happening in India? We shared, I hope I'm audible. Am I?
Yes, sir.
In India, we isolated the virus in the month of March through ICMR NIV. And then subsequently, we shared this virus, not only for diagnostic tests, but also for vaccine development. And that's how the first indigenous vaccine of Bharat Biotech could actually be developed. They were given this virus, and the subsequent vaccine development.
There is a lot of echo.
People will have to mute
There is no echo at our end, sir.
So echo is at my end.
Go ahead.
Not at our side.
Yeah. It's fine, sir.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
So one thing that happened was we started with respect to development of vaccines. Serum Institute was also sensitized very early, and the Oxford collaboration went off well. And then subsequently, you find that the vaccine trials were started sometime in the month of July for the indigenous vaccine. AstraZeneca vaccine trial was already going outside in South Africa and England. And therefore, they only needed to do what is called as bridging trials to prove that the vaccine does not produce different kind of a profile in terms of toxicities in India. And you found that in the month of January, to be precise, on January 16th, India launched its vaccine. Now, both the vaccines were given approval, Covishield as well as Covaxin. Now, what are these vaccines actually? Now, these vaccines, you know, once you share the sequence of a genome of SARS-CoV-2, there are different approaches that people can adopt. What were the different approaches? You know, there are traditional approaches. One of the traditional approach that you have seen is with Bharat Biotech. What Bharat Biotech did was use the entire virus, inactivate that virus so that it doesn't replicate once given inside the body, and ensure that the body will be exposed to different viral proteins and produce antibodies against it, which is a very traditional platform. But one must remember that the world, when it tried to develop vaccines against HIV as well as Ebola, they tried to develop different vaccine platforms. Now, what do we exactly mean by vaccine platforms? Now, this particular virus tends to enter into a nematocyte using a protein which is called as spike protein. And there is another factor which is also known as TIMPRSS. Now, spike protein continues to remain the most important pathway through which the virus is going to make the entry. So people actually decoded those genes which perhaps need to be used in vaccine development so that the spike protein can be produced once you introduce those genes into the human body. So how can you do that? No, one must remember that if we recall our physiology days, you know, the how the proteins are produced in the body. No, what we do is we have all the information that perhaps you need to produce a particular protein, which is stored in our DNA. Now, when you have this information there, DNA produces a different template, which is looking actually opposite of what you would look at the DNA, which is called as messenger RNA template. And this messenger RNA is actually like a postman, which carries all the information as to how to produce this spike protein. And then this particular protein, mRNA, this messenger RNA actually helps our own ribosomes to produce these proteins which are intended to be produced. So naturally, what will happen when it comes to vaccine development, you could use a DNA that encodes spike protein, so that if you give the DNA, you will find that the spike protein will be generated. Now, which is the vaccine that is available to us of that kind? The vaccine that is going to come in future, if it is successful, is one that is developed by Zydus Cadila, called as Zycord V vaccine against this particular virus. The second approach could be, instead of using DNA, I would use mRNA and use that mRNA to produce the spike protein. Now, this approach was used by Pfizer and Moderna, but it had its own issues because messenger RNAs are extremely unstable at room temperature. And since they are unstable at room temperature, you need to actually try and store them at a temperature like minus 80 and then try to provide this particular vaccine very quickly, so that this mRNA does not degrade. That's a big handicap with Pfizer and Moderna vaccine as such. Now, the third way to produce this vaccine is try to provide, you know, spike protein or parts of spike protein, so that the body recognizes those parts of spike protein and produces vaccine against it. Now, which is the vaccine that you are likely to see in India? It is called as Corovax. That comes from Novavax company, which will be produced by Serum Institute very shortly. And even that vaccine should ideally be available to us maybe by September month in India also. Now, this is a subunit vaccine of spike protein. So spike protein's different fragments are used to produce this particular vaccine. The fourth vaccine we all know, fourth approach we all know, is whole inactivated virus, which has been used in Covaxin. Now, these four different approaches led to discovery of vaccine very rapidly. And the reason why it could happen very quickly was, one, you know, the high incidence of this infection. Most of the trials that were conducted, they were parallel trials that were conducted. Because we didn't have time, the virus tends to spread dramatically fast, and therefore people thought that if I conduct trials simultaneously, perhaps I will be able to produce these vaccines very quickly. Generally, vaccine production used to require 7 to 10 years time, but there were certain learnings that we had, especially from H1N1 vaccine, which was put to use. And then subsequently, we tried to produce a vaccine which was produced in a dramatically short period of 10 months time. Now, when you produce a vaccine of this kind, most often what will happen? People will become skeptics. People will think, I don't know how they could produce this vaccine rapidly. Is that efficacious? What kind of side effects profile would it have? Now, one thing which we have to remember, that these vaccines did not bypass any regulatory approaches that were required to be utilized in vaccine production. When you look at those two vaccines, which are mRNA-based vaccines, the surprise came from their efficacy that they could produce. The efficacy was just around 95%. Earlier, WHO had said that it perhaps even efficacy around 50% should be sufficient to actually introduce this vaccine in public health settings as such. But 95% was completely a surprise for all of us. But when we say 95%, what does it exactly mean, or the efficacy that we by and large see? No, you will find that the efficacy essentially means that if I provide vaccine to 100 people, whether it is serums, Covishield, Covaxin, Moderna, or for that matter, Pfizer's vaccine, what will happen is, out of those 100 people, you will find almost none of them will die due to COVID infection. Most of them, 95% of them, that is 95 of them, will not develop a severe COVID disease. But what does this vaccine not do? The vaccine cannot prevent primary infection or the infection that could occur to an individual. If I move around and move in the society after taking vaccines, now what might happen if I'm exposed to an individual who has COVID disease? I am still likely to get the infection, but the infection is likely to be asymptomatic or mild. And most often people don't know that part. And the result is people tend to complain that the vaccine is not efficacious as such. Please remember, these are first generation vaccines. When the second generation vaccines will come, perhaps they would have a dramatic impact also on the transmission that might occur, or the risk of acquisition of this particular virus. That's another thing that we have to think about. Subsequently, you find that there are two vaccines which came into play. One is adenovirus-based, vector-based vaccines. This technology was used for development of Covishield and Sputnik V vaccine. And what do we mean by adenovirus vector? No, this is an adenovirus. Adenovirus, which is generally a virus that causes common cold. And once, you know, by and large, almost 1 in 5 individuals would have antibodies against adenoviruses. But these adenoviruses are very safe to carry the genetic material inside to produce different proteins. These adenoviruses have been tried extensively in development of experimental vaccines against HIV as well as Ebola. So what these people did was one of those innovative ideas. They did not want to choose an adenovirus that was found in human beings. So what they did was they isolated, for AstraZeneca vaccine, the Covishield, they isolated a chimpanzee's virus from its stool, which has never infected human beings, cut that virus DNA material, put in the DNA encoding spike protein inside that virus. This virus is a non-replicating virus. So once I introduce in the body, I will not be developing adenovirus infection, but a fixed amount of this DNA that encodes for spike protein is introduced inside the body. When the DNA goes inside, DNA goes into the nucleus. Messenger RNA tries to utilize the cellular machinery to produce spike protein. And that is how spike protein tends to be generated. And therefore, this works as a vaccine. This is how Covishield tends to work. When it comes to Sputnik V, you know, they understood that all these vaccines, excepting Johnson & Johnson's vaccine, which is single dose vaccine, they require two dosages of vaccine. So what they did is, in Sputnik V, they considered that if I provide first dose from an adenovirus, when I provide the second dose, it is quite possible that my body will produce antibodies against adenovirus. And therefore, when I give the second dose, probably the vaccine may not be as successful in generating antibodies, because my antibody titers will neutralize this adenovirus, and therefore the success of the immunization might be lesser. So what they did was another innovation. They chose an adenovirus which is normally not found to infect human beings, but it has a capability to infect human beings. So they used a strain which is called as adenovirus 26 in the first dose, and the second dose has adenovirus 5, which is a different virus, and therefore the take of the vaccine can be much better because there are two different viruses given in two different dosages that we provide. In Covaxin or even Sinopharm, which was a vaccine that was developed by China, these vaccines actually used whole inactivated virions, which contain not only spike protein, but it also contains other epitopes to which my body could be utilized. And therefore, it might have a larger scope of protecting an individual from different variants that tend to come. So these vaccines were also produced. Now, one of the issues that comes is, what about its efficacy? Majority of these vaccines have an efficacy that could range between 80 to 90% as such. If you look at Bharat Biotech's vaccine, it is around 78%. When it comes to AstraZeneca's vaccine, perhaps the protection is close to about 70%. But should we worry about them? Absolutely not. One of the things which we have to realize, efficacy is in a tight controlled setting. But when it comes to real-time life setting, we don't see any kind of differences would occur between different vaccines. All vaccines should otherwise be treated as vaccines that are of equal protection value. Now, if I take those vaccines, what are certain things which I must know? That these are two-dose vaccines. When I say two-dose vaccines, one of the issues which we have to realize that the duration or the interval that you require to take the second dose is different for different vaccines. When it comes to Covishield, you can take this vaccine as the second dose. You can take the second dose between 4 to 12 weeks of time, and still your generation of immune response would not be affected. Then the second thing which we must remember is, when it comes to Covaxin, you have to take it after 4 weeks of taking the first dose. When it comes to Sputnik V, Sputnik V has to be taken 3 weeks after provision of the first dose. So that these are some things which I must remember of the dosages as such. Now, as we said, these vaccines by and large tend to give you adequate protection, and majority of these vaccines are known to produce an impact which is favorable, that is 100% reduction in deaths that could occur because of coronavirus infection. There may be differences in reducing the risk of development of severe COVID disease, but by and large it is assumed that nobody dies if the person has already received two dosages of vaccine. Now, if I take, let's say, one dose of vaccine, when would I be protected? If you look at Moderna and Pfizer, you tend to be protected by 12th day of the first dose of the vaccine that has been provided. If it is Covishield vaccine, for Covishield you require about 22 days time, and a similar time is required even for Covaxin. So the first dose tends to protect to you after 3 weeks in Indian setting. As of now, the protection may not be adequate, because why do we give second dose? By giving second dose, we ensure that the titers of the neutralizing antibodies that are generated continue to be higher. Their ability to bind to an antigen, which is an organism itself, is likely to be higher. So two dosages have to be taken, and that's something which we must remember. So taking two dosages can also be pose some kind of challenge. One challenge is, people are worried about the side effects that tend to occur. One must remember that the side effects that occur by majority are those which are local and systemic side effects. What do we exactly mean by that? If I take Covishield vaccine, majority of the people, when they go for the first dose, they will develop fever, tenderness at the site of injection. Some of them may develop fatigue. Some of them may develop headache. Some of them may perhaps also have joint pains as one of the manifestations. And fever continues to be a predominant side effect that you see. Now, are these side effects more difficult to handle? Perhaps not. Just taking paracetamol for it, these side effects will disappear in 2 days' time after taking the first dose. Now, what happens when you have to take the second dose? Because some of us will be worried that the first dose gave rise to so much of toxicity that there was fever, there was fatigue, and they may refuse to go for second dose. What is most important to remember? That the toxicities, in terms of number of days those toxicities could last, the severity of a toxicity that is witnessed is likely to be lower when it comes to second dose. So second dose is not associated with so much of toxicities. Now, people are not worried about these minor side effects when you teach them. But most often they are worried about anaphylactic shock that might occur. Can that occur so easily? Perhaps not. The frequency continues to be more than 1 in 100,000 people. So that's not a big worry that we should keep at the back of mind. But any person who had a prior case of developing anaphylactic shock after receiving a vaccine dose, you should try to protect that individual by saying that perhaps you would not be eligible to receive this vaccine. Or if you are to receive it, you should receive it under strict medical supervision, as we have kept on prescribing in the vaccine rollout program. For a half an hour, the patient would be observed. And why half an hour? Because most often severe toxicities that could occur immediately after vaccination, they tend to occur within half an hour's time. Now, who are the people in whom it would be seen more often? Among those who have food allergy, especially like egg allergy, or allergy towards any vaccine constituent. One needs to worry about that part. And most often these toxicities are more likely to be seen among females, but all of them continue to be manageable. So people should not worry about major toxicities and run away from taking this particular vaccine. The fraction that doesn't need to take the vaccine or should not take the vaccine continues to be very small as a rare event that might happen. Now, there are people who say, I have allergic tendency. No, I have asthma. I have, let's say, eczema. Should I take the vaccine? Of course, you should take the vaccine. This does not produce anaphylactic shock as one of the manifestations. No, unless you have history of severe allergy that manifests into anaphylactic shock, please do not worry. Vaccines are safe enough. There are people who would say that is it going to be something like gene therapy and therefore there could be long-term toxicities? Absolutely not. One must remember that this virus is not like whatever we are taking as of now are not gene therapy-like vaccines. The virus is actually carrying genes that encode for spike protein. These genes do not get integrated into the host genome, so we should not worry about it. There is another myth that tends to continue in the mind of people. Now, if I take the vaccine, would I become sterile or would it affect my fertility? It has nothing to do with that. When people say, does it contain pork or cow's proteins? No, that is also not true. We don't need to worry about that. There are people who think, I had COVID in the past, so should I take the vaccine? Yes, you must take the vaccine. Why should you take the vaccine? The reason is that when you get natural infection, you do not produce adequate strong response uniformly by generating antibodies for every person who's infected by the COVID virus itself. But when you actually artificially try to protect him by vaccination, you are giving fixed dose of that particular protein, and therefore your immune responses are likely to be similar and strong enough. So one has to take the vaccine. Now, the second issue that comes is, if I have to take the vaccine, then when should I take this vaccine if I had COVID in the recent past? There is one thing which we must remember. ideally, if you had COVID, your body is going to produce antibodies against this virus itself. Now, if I have antibodies in my blood, and then I give vaccine to such an individual, what will happen? You will find that these antibodies will attack the adenovirus or whole inactivated virus, and my macrophages will try to eat this particular whatever adenovirus that you have given or the whole inactivated virus that we have provided, and therefore the success of immunization will be far lesser. So when should I take the first dose? You should ideally take it after 3 months, because IgG levels by and large tend to drop off after 3 months' time. But would that be a fixed kind of an approach? Perhaps not. If you are providing the first dose to somebody who had COVID infection in recent past, and currently we are passing through a very severe rise in infection, something like what we are seeing in the second wave, perhaps you should drop down that period from 3 months to 2 months, because this will help the patient. Even if there is no adequate titer that you actually aimed at to produce inside the body, there will be at least a major protection that will save his life to a larger degree. Now we come to another issue. Some people say that I was admitted and now my vaccine's turn has come. Now, should I take the vaccine at that time? You should not. Why should you not take the vaccine? If I'm suffering from COVID, my immune system is already suppressed because of COVID infection itself. All of us must be remembering that majority of those who have COVID, they tend to have very low lymphocytic count. No, very small proportion of lymphocytes are available. Until the time, no, those become to go towards normal, it essentially is telling you that your immune suppression is continues to be there. So if I provide vaccine now, my immune system will not produce sufficient quantity of antibodies because it is already suppressed. So what should I do? I must wait, at least wait for a period that could be lasting for about 6 weeks' time to 12 weeks' time, and then go for taking vaccines. That's another dictum that we have to remember. There are patients who are let's say having malignancy. Now, should I be receiving vaccine? Absolutely yes. Should I be receiving vaccine, and what should be my bigger worry? The only bigger worry that you could have is perhaps in those settings, the titers of antibodies that you need to achieve are unlikely to be very high if it is a worst case scenario. If I am HIV infected, should I be receiving vaccine? Absolutely. The reason is very simple. If I am HIV infected, if I am receiving antiretroviral therapy, I must take the vaccine because my immune system is stabilized. My responses are likely to be dependent on the level of immunosuppression. But what is most important for me is to reduce the risk of development of death as an adverse outcome that may come about because of this. As orthopedicians, some of you must have been using monoclonal antibodies against rheumatoid arthritis after correction or whatever when it comes to management. Should you be providing this vaccine to somebody who's receiving monoclonal antibody? Absolutely. Please go ahead. Nothing happens if you provide a vaccine to somebody who's receiving monoclonal antibody. The second issue that we have to think about is, can I provide this vaccine to somebody who's pregnant? No, there is one dictum that we must remember. The trials that have recently been concluded are only among the adult population, which is non-pregnant. We have not conducted trials in pregnant women, so nobody has that data. However, in routine rollout of vaccine, let's say in USA or wherever, they have kept a pregnancy registry open. And what is essentially seen, that if a woman has received a vaccine while she was pregnant, now what happens is 13% of these pregnancies are likely to be preterm. What is the next thing that might happen? You might also see that there is small for gestational age. It is likely. Just give me a minute. I don't know why they are calling so early. 1 minute, huh? Just give me a 1 minute, a single minute.
Yes, sir.
Now, what might essentially happen, there was a call for another program. I don't know why they called so early. But the bigger worry with respect to pregnancy is it may produce about 3% children who are small for gestational age. So the decision is up to you. You have to evaluate risk and benefits and try to provide vaccine. If you feel that the risk of acquisition of this infection is very high, then in those cases, you may inform the pregnant woman and still go ahead with vaccines. Now, the second issue that is also important for us to understand, can I provide the vaccine during lactation? Yes, you can provide the vaccine during lactation. There is no issue surrounding that. Now, if I have received convalescent plasma, then how long should I wait before I provide vaccine? You need to wait for a period of about 3 months, and only then you should be able to provide this vaccine at that juncture. I would try to quickly wrap up because we could take different questions that may come through. But there are a few things which I would say. Today, second wave is very severe. Now, we had prioritized the population in different ways. The last priority was 45 years plus population. Why did we have 45 years plus population? The reason was that the risk of death or development of severe COVID disease is extremely high compared to less than 45 years population. And therefore, we wanted to ensure that 100% saturation of 45 plus population would be extremely useful to us. But now you have 18 years plus population that has been added. So what should you be doing? Even in this second wave that tends to come, just give me, I don't know how to, hello?
No issues, sir. I'll mute you.
Hey, oh, 7 baje hai na? नहीं 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 मैं दूसरा भाषण दे रहा हूँ मैं बाद में आऊंगा आई एम सॉरी एम आई ऑडिबल
यस सर
यस यस
रियली सॉरी नो दे अननेसेसरली दिस इज दूरदर्शन ट्राइंग टू कॉन्टैक्ट एनीवे बट व्हाट आई वाज सेइंग वाज No, what is more important is you should try to tell all those who are 45 years plus to take the vaccine. No, 18 years plus, the effect is going to be suspect. Why do we need to prioritize 45 years plus? One, it reduces the risk of death. Second thing, which is also important for us, it takes almost 1.5 months to produce the effect of 2-dose vaccines. Even if I provide one single dose of vaccine, today there are sufficient international examples. One that comes from the least developed countries, that is Chile. It tends to show that where the third wave was very strong, when they started providing vaccine single dose, they found that they could reduce the bend the curve very rapidly. So please ensure that first go for 45 years plus that perhaps helps us a lot at this time point. Now, as doctors, what should we be doing? We must be taking this vaccine. Does this vaccine protect against variants? So far, yes. All the variants that have come, you might have lower efficacy of the vaccine, but that doesn't necessarily mean that the vaccine is not going to protect you. It 100% protects you from death. Please go ahead and take that vaccine. Why healthcare workers must take it? One must remember that the risk of exposure is continuous, almost continuous for healthcare workers. And therefore, if they want to save their own lives and serve the people, you must take the vaccine for sure. The second issue that you must remember, it's not only you taking the vaccine, but you are going to continue in the profession. if you want to safeguard yourself against the risk of acquiring this infection, you must ensure that you promote vaccination to others so that the number of people who could come as patients to you do not remain most often the way here today we have, that is those who are COVID positive. Now, let's try to reduce our exposure by promoting vaccine to 45 years plus as of now. And then you could go, once you saturate all, go to 18 years plus up to 45 years age group. Please take the vaccines if you want to. Please don't worry about variants. Variants are going to come. How long is this protection going to last? Current data tends to suggest that even if you take vaccine, the vaccine may last, protection may last up to a year's time. So in any case, you will have to take a booster dose of vaccine, a newer dose, which will be working against a variant. Is that a hope that newer vaccines will also come against variants? There are 227 scientific groups or commercial groups which are trying to develop vaccine, and most of the vaccines are in preclinical development stage. So you will find that there will be a flow of vaccines that will come and cover the risk of acquiring even an infection from a variant, but cover the risk today of acquiring infection from the coronavirus that is circulating as of now. Now, of all these vaccines, most of them are intramuscular. And therefore, what happens is they don't protect you against infection. Because if you want to protect you from acquiring infection, you must have presence of serum immunoglobulin A or secretory immunoglobulin A inside your nasopharynx as such. Now, that can only happen if you take an oral vaccine or a nasal vaccine. Because when you provide it through intramuscular route, you are unlikely to develop these secretory antibodies. And that's why the risk of acquiring infection continues to exist, even if the risk of death or severe COVID infection tends to go down dramatically. Is there a hope in that direction? Yes, there is a hope. Probably you might see, if the vaccine trials are successful, by September, October, you might have Bharat Biotech's nasal vaccine, which will come, which will make our lives little easier. There is one company called as Prema's Biotech, which is developing a oral vaccine. All this can happen only if, you know, we continue to ensure that our efforts to immunize people are rapidly tend to take ground very shortly. We can bend the curve if we saturate the population by vaccination, especially among those who are 45 years plus. Even if I am vaccinated or I am unvaccinated, we must continue to ensure that we follow COVID appropriate behavior, ensure that we use PPEs adequately so that we are not exposed again and again. And COVID appropriate behaviors are going to ensure that you will not acquire variants if you use them properly. I think I will stop here and ask for questions, because in another 15 minutes, they will again start contacting and make my life difficult.
Thank you very much, sir, for enlightening us on this very important aspect of vaccination in the purview of second wave. It was very informative, and almost all the doubts which are in the mind of common person or person, they have been solved by your talk. Now the session is open for question and answer. We'll take only few question and answer so that sir has to go.
I want to ask you one question.
Yeah.
If we are having COVID infection, 3 months or 4 months pass, then 1 year pass, so whether one immunization dose is sufficient or we have to take again 2 doses?
That's a good question in a sense, because we all know that when somebody gets immunized or somebody gets natural infection, it's not only that immunoglobulins are produced against it or Ig antibodies are produced against it through B cells, but there is a T cell sensitization that also occurs, and T cells are actually to ensure that next time if you are exposed, the T cells should press themselves into action and produce the required antibodies rapidly. But there is one worry that all of us have. What is the adequate level at which T cell sensitization tends to occur? Therefore, currently what we say, take two dosages of vaccine. Now, can we take one dose? There is only one paper that has been published recently, which says that the titers, even after taking only one dose, is as much as you would get after taking two dosages if you were infected by COVID in the past. But can that become a public policy? So far, the evidence is not so strong. So we continue to say, take two dosages as of now, rather than one dose, even if you had a COVID infection in the past.
Sir, if someone is interested to get pregnant after vaccination, how much time someone can take chance for a pregnancy?
For taking chance for pregnancy, you don't need to worry because this vaccine is not teratogenic. Even if you have taken it, let's say 1.5 months, when after which the woman is becoming pregnant, there is no worry that there would be any congenital anomaly.
So there is one question from Dr. Amit Kale. I wanted to ask risk related to Covishield vaccine in person having coagulopathy, idiopathic on warfarin.
Yeah, the risk is more related to one, bleeding. Second thing which is happening is there is newer data that is emerging on PF4 antibodies, but should we worry about it? No, those cases of cerebral thrombosis are far rarer than what we imagine. Perhaps it would be prudent to take it as a very rare event rather than worry about it.
Sir, I have one basic question. Initially, Covishield and Covaxin were given, and the second dose was given after 1 month, say, both. In between, the schedule was changed. Covishield was given after 6 to 8 months. Is there any scientific reason or some other reason for this?
Now, I think I should not be quoted outside. To my mind, it is more for convenience. What they found was, even if you give it up to 3 months, the effect is not altered. So in UK, when they tried to vaccinate, they realized that they have to vaccinate larger number of people and the dosages were insufficient. So what they did was, if I give a single dose, then would that be sufficient? The trial, the study that they talk of is a very small study. I would say the rigor with which it should have been done continues to be on the lower step. But the good part is, even if you take it up to 3 months, it continues to remain effective. But that doesn't mean that I should advocate that the dose interval between two dosages can be 3 months, because one must also remember that the more the gap is, the more is the likelihood that the patient may not take the second dose.
Sir, you have just mentioned ki for COVID 4 to 3 months and for Covaxin 4 weeks and that Russian vaccine for 3 weeks.
3 weeks.
So we already have taken COVID shield, and should we take the second dose after 4 weeks, 6 weeks? When should we take the...
As of now, I would say 6 weeks is more than enough. We should not wait longer, because the second wave is very strong.
So, sir, is it necessary to take both the vaccines same, or can we go for the another vaccine?
Ideally, you should take both the vaccines, dosages as the same from one particular vaccine.
Sir, I am immunized and got vaccinated, and my immunity is going to last for 1 year. In case in this period I do have infections which are subclinical, will my immunity last longer than 1 year?
I don't think so, but it is very difficult to answer the question because we do not know what we call as surrogates of protection. No, there are people who are continuously doing antibody test after taking vaccine, and they say, I have no antibody, or yes, antibody at this particular level. Will it remain protective? We don't know. No, because there are no studies to indicate that very well in human beings. There is only one animal study that has been done where they found that anti-RBD ELISA with a titer of more than 137 can be considered as protective amongst animals. But we don't have human data. Why am I telling this? That even if you get repeated infection, we do not know what is protective level of antibody that we can tell you don't need to take the vaccine. Perhaps your immunity is going to last longer. We also know that after natural infection, the antibodies tend to decay within 6 months period. Theoretically, what you say could be a possibility, but my worry would be different. If somebody keeps on getting infection of COVID, despite having been immunized, you might find that it may be put as a challenge for the virus to mutate more, and newer variants would perhaps be detected. So I would be cautious in saying whether it would increase the duration of protection if you keep on acquiring COVID infection in between after vaccination.
Thank you. So if inadvertently, if anybody has taken one dose of Covishield and one dose of Covaxin, what he's supposed to do?
No, if it has been taken inadvertently, you don't need to worry. No, because both are going to remain effective. But what might eventually happen, no? If I have taken adenovirus-based vaccine, and let's say there is a booster that is going to come, which is required to be developed because there is a variant that has come, then you might find I have antibodies against that adenovirus in my body. So my ability to have a successful immunization with the same booster would always be reduced, right? So I would like to have a cross protection coming from a different platform. Now it could have had been Covaxin, it could have had been mRNA vaccine, or it could have had been any other vaccine that might come. But mixing two dosages can impact that. No, mainly because you are exposed to two different platforms. So next dose that you might give may have to be a little different platform. But it will happen because in India also, mRNA vaccine is being produced by MQR. And hopefully that should also become available if it is successful. But don't worry about mix-up that has happened.
Sir, just now you explained us that IgG antibodies, which we are going to be developed because of this intramuscular vaccination, and the surface vaccination, which are going to produce the IgA antibodies. So does it beneficial that once we take the IgG, this present vaccination, and later on, if this surface vaccination comes, can we have it?
Yes. No, these are going to be two different vaccines, no? Because one must suspect that these would be attenuated vaccines. If it is nasal vaccine, they may use whole virion, but it will be attenuated virion. So you can always take that vaccine whenever it comes.
Sir, after this vaccination, can we take painkiller, paracetamol, Diclonac? Because many times we read that after taking Diclonac injection or paracetamol injection, some complication has occurred.
No, paracetamol is fine, not NSAIDs. NSAIDs should not be taken.
Okay.
Sir, suppose sir, one patient is on immunosuppressant and he is taking vaccination, whether he is going to get benefit similar to the normal human being or there is some less response?
No, as I said, it all depends on level of immunosuppression. If I am very much suppressed, my response is not going to be so good for vaccination. But like for HIV infected people, if my CD4 is high, my viral load is suppressed, I don't need to worry, my responses will be similar.
Sir, what even after second sir? Dose of vaccine, sir, I'm Dr. Lingayat. Even after second dose of vaccine, some people are not getting required titer, antibody titer. What is the reason for that?
See, that is what I said. No, we do not know correlates of protection. Now, when you say antibody titers, these are diagnostics which are used for exposure to virus. Now, these are cruder tests, in other words. Now, so these tests cannot be applied to say whether you are protected or not protected. The surrogates of protection, that is a test for detecting whether an individual is protected or not, in human beings is not yet available. People are working over it. So don't go by antibody titers alone. That doesn't tell you much. T cell sensitization may still have had occurred and you could have it been protected.
Sir, there is a question from our IOA president, Dr. Shiv Shankar. Can we take multiple vaccinations from different companies?
What I would say is, please be conservative in taking vaccines from different virus platforms, which are used for not virus, vaccine development platforms. The reason why I say that is, it is possible that what we are likely to see as epidemiology tomorrow is, you have this strain, now you would have a new variant, there will be another variant which will come, which will not be able to, where vaccine may not be able to protect you. So if I have to give subsequent dose to protect you, I may require other vaccines. No? So if I use all those platforms right away, that's not going to give me any advantage. So wait. No, it's like a use of antibiotics. No,
yeah.
If you use all kinds of antibiotic options at one go, then you are exhausting your options. It is better to go by algorithms.
In future, any vaccine program is indicated for children below 18 years?
Pfizer vaccine is already approved in USA between 12 to 18 years as of now. For younger children, still the vaccine trials have not covered that age group. It is quite possible that some results might come perhaps by next year, mid next year.
Sir, one out of the box question, please.
Yeah.
Sir, this virus has a biological base or it is a genetic engineered lab originated virus?
I would not like to believe that it is genetically engineered and biological weapon. No country is so foolish that such a weapon will be delivered which could disturb the humanity, because it also finishes off their own population at the same time. Now, these kinds of questions come to our mind mainly because we have failed in controlling this infection, whereas China appears to have won. This is a very defensive kind of a thinking where we tend to blame some other country. This happened in HIV. In HIV also, people used to say, this is a virus that is developed by USA and spread across. Now, we must remember that successes and learning from those successes of countries which have controlled should be an appropriate strategy. Accept that the infection is here. Don't try to put the blame on other countries, because then your way of thinking gets so affected that you will not be able to take rational strategies and implement them.
Thank you very much, sir, for giving you.
Last question. Yeah, sir, yeah, there are certain vaccines which are only single dose based, and certain vaccines are required two doses. Why this difference is there?
No, the reason is, you know, if you ask me, people did two dose vaccines because they thought the potency of these spike proteins may not be so high to provoke these antibodies. And that's the reason all the trials that were conducted had two dose vaccine. Johnson & Johnson thought otherwise, and they used a vaccine trial where they have used only one dose of vaccine. It is possible that over a period of time, you will find that all vaccine manufacturers will come up with trials which would suggest, or data that would suggest, that one dose is sufficient. But currently, when you don't have the data, you have to believe on what is being done so far in the trial. Because the dose that is given, you know, of the DNA that you encode continues to depend on two different dosages as such. One factor which we must never forget, the more the dosages that you provide, the stronger is the immune response. Now look at the boosters that you give in childhood immunization. You know, whenever you want to give more than one dose, you are better off largely. Though I also agree that this particular virus is not a virus which has an envelope of glycoproteins. No? So the immunogenicity is lesser, but still, you know, using the rational evidence-based data, I would still say those vaccine trials where they use two dosages should be considered as two-dose vaccine. Johnson & Johnson's, it should be treated as one-dose vaccine.
Thank you very much, sir. You have given your valuable time to us. I am thankful to you from Maharashtra Orthopedic Association for guiding us on this very important aspect, and especially in this full swing of second wave. I am thankful to Dr. V.N. Deshpande, sir, also, who has coordinated this event and made this happen within a short notice of time. I am thankful to all our past presidents for joining this program. I am thankful to our president, Dr. Shinde, sir, secretary, Dr. Karne, sir, and all executive committee members for encouraging and helping in happening this program. And I am thankful to all the viewers who are seeing this program, for attending this program. And last but not least, I am thankful to Dr. Shiv Shankar, sir, our president of IO, who has also encouraged us to take this program, and Dr. Ashok Shyam of Artho TV, who has helped us to relay all this program and seamlessly and without any disturbances. I am thankful to Ashok for his kind help. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you. Yeah.
And my apologies for interruption.
No, sir. We can understand.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for guidance and clearing our all.
Thank you, sir.
Doubts.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. From all.
Yeah. Thank you.